We're here in Psalm chapter number 16, and we'll read a few verses here. Psalm 16 and verse number 1. Preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. Their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. The Lord is my portion, is the portion of mine inheritance and mine cup. Thou maintainest my lot. The lions are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For thou shalt not leave my soul in hell, neither shall suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures for evermore. Let's have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for the privilege that we have this evening to gather together with believers, to open your word, and to hear from you. God, I pray that you would encourage us tonight and challenge us in areas that perhaps need to be challenged. And we thank you ultimately for the satisfaction that we have in you. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. How many of you have seen this phrase before? Satisfaction guaranteed. Satisfaction guaranteed. How many of you ever committed to a service? Maybe you signed up for someone to come fix something at your house, or you paid for a service and you weren't satisfied with the service that you received. I think if we're all being honest, we can all raise our hand and attest to that. Well, there was a man named Roy Pearson, and he famously sued a Washington, D.C. dry cleaner for $54 million for losing a pair of his pants. This was a judge that filed the lawsuit. And the whole reasoning for his suit was that the dry cleaners had promised satisfaction guaranteed. And they didn't deliver on that promise. This court went through many different courts, went through some appeals court. Ultimately, the dry cleaners lost, but had to go out of business because of all the legal battles that were waged because of this phrase, satisfaction guaranteed. What the court found was that satisfaction is subjective. If you claim to be the cheapest coffee shop in town, that can be verified. But if you claim to be the best coffee shop in town, that's subjective. One person may say yes, and the other person may say no, so you can make a subjective claim like that. We live in a time where satisfaction is fleeting. I read a Gallup report from a couple months ago, and it was a survey done on American satisfaction, and you wouldn't be surprised to know that the American satisfaction is at some of its lowest levels that it's ever been before. Satisfaction, just are you satisfied in life? And so we find people chasing satisfaction. It seems like that satisfaction is often elusive. But what we come tonight in God's word is the satisfaction that we find in him. I was encouraged by this quote from Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards said, God is glorified not only by his glories being seen, but by its being rejoiced in. When those that see it delight in it, God is more glorified than if they only see it. And so what we find here is we find David, he's writing a psalm. This is a psalm that is written in times of turmoil. But the theme of this psalm is satisfaction. That's instructive to our hearts because we can find satisfaction no matter what season that we're in. And when we do find that satisfaction and we glorify God in that satisfaction, he is then immensely glorified. And so we find here the psalmist writing about satisfaction. And I want to point out a few areas that we read just a moment ago in which we find this satisfaction, and we can find this satisfaction as well. And it's not just in circumstances. It's not just in our checking accounts. It's not just in our relationship. This is true satisfaction. So let me point out a few areas from this passage, and we'll just work verse by verse down through this. Look at verse number 1. We read it a moment ago. Preserve me, O God, And what he's saying there is he's saying, protect me, right? He's surrounded by enemies. This is a time of difficulty. And he says, for in thee do I put my trust. So this is a specific choice that the psalmist is going to make to run to God in times of difficulty, in times of turmoil. He says, God, would you protect me? And I am going to run to you. I'm going to place my trust in you and make that decision. Oh, my soul, that thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord, my goodness extendeth not to thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. So there's a few things that we find in this first few verses of Psalm chapter number 16. The first thing I want to point out is that the wise run to God and they find satisfaction. When turmoil comes, when difficulty comes, the wise believer will run to God and in that find satisfaction. We read this verse number 2 just a moment ago, but the second part of that verse, we read, my goodness extendeth not to thee. So here, David proclaims the goodness of God, but then he says, my goodness doesn't extend to you. What is he saying there? He's saying and recognizing that he can't reciprocate the goodness that God extends to him. There's a special humility in that. Have you ever gotten a gift before where you were just so blown away by the gift and you wanted to give something back because the gift was that good? You felt compelled to do something in return, but the gift was so great, you couldn't even do anything in return. There's a man named Jimmy. My wife told me about this account online. He goes around, I think we might have a picture of him, and he gives to people. He finds out people that are needy, that are down and out, maybe had some difficulties a lot of times through no fault of their own. And he finds out what their needs are, and he goes to them, and he meets their needs, whether it's paying a car payment or paying a bill. And his account online has amassed millions and millions of followers. He's had a national audience now, been on all the major news outlets. And what he does is he just is kind to people, but what makes it so compelling is that he's kind to people that can't reciprocate his goodness. They have nothing to offer. And what we find so oftentimes is when he bestows this kindness to these individuals, that they are overwhelmed. They want to do something in return. They want to reciprocate that kindness. And what David here is saying is, I can't give you anything back to the Lord. This is a great reminder for us that we, even in our righteousness, is as filthy rags, the Bible says. There's nothing good in us. There's nothing that we can extend and reciprocate back to the Lord. C.H. Spurgeon said in a sermon one time, I receive all good from thee, but no good can I return to thee. Wherefore, I acknowledge thee to be most rich and myself to be most beggarly. That's one of the great things that God can do in times of difficulty is really make us keenly aware of ourselves and our need and our dependence for him. That's what David says. I enjoy your goodness. I didn't earn your goodness. I can't repay you, but I see and I understand and I appreciate your goodness. And then look at verse number 3. But to the saints that are in the earth and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. So if you follow carefully in these verses, David just says, I'm only going to delight in thee, you're only good. But then he says, I'm going to delight in the saints. He's going to delight in the people of God. Now, this is really good. David does not see any inconsistency with saying that God, you and you alone are good and your people are good. Why? Because God's people are a gift from God. And when we enjoy the fellowship and the presence from one another, we are in turn glorifying God. Isn't that great? That we have the blessing. That's one of the things I love about a church family, a household of faith, is that we have one another. And when we are good to one another, that glorifies God. We're enjoying his goodness by enjoying our fellowship together, fellowship around the gospel, fellowship around his word. Isn't that good tonight? That David says, God, you're good, you're only good, and by the way, your people are good. The time spent in your word is good. I'm refreshed by this. So the wise, they run to God and they find satisfaction. But the unwise, what do they do? Look at verse number 4. Their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. So what he's pointing out is the contrast. David is pointing out the contrast between those who run to God in times of turmoil and the unwise that run away from God. We've all seen people who have had difficulty into their life, that use that difficulty as an excuse to flee away from God. And there's others that have encountered similar difficulties and have ran to God in their time of need. This is the contrast that David is pointing out. And he's pointing out here, their sorrows shall be multiplied. To have a problem and to run from the only one that invites us to cast our problems to him, what it does is it just multiplies the problem. Their sorrows will be multiplied. At a time in need, rather than run to God, to run away from God doesn't solve any problems. It multiplies the problems. Matthew Henry said this, "Those that multiply gods multiply grief to themselves. For whosoever thinks one God too little will find two too many and yet hundreds not enough." We see this in our society today where people, they find a God in alcohol or different drug use or different different vices and different, maybe a wrong relationship, and there's a hurt, so they go and find it and fill a hole that only God can fill with something else that was only meant to be God. And what we find is problems are multiplied. So David sees this too. He sees those that pursue not God, but they run and they drink the offerings of blood. And David makes the conscious decision that God, even though I'm hurting, even though I'm frightened and I'm scared, I'm going to run to you. I'm going to run to you and find satisfaction. So what do we find satisfaction in? We find satisfaction in his protection, in the safety and the security that we find in him. So the wise run to God in satisfaction. The unwise will run to God in, I think that was mixed up on the screen. The wise will run to God and find satisfaction. The unwise will run to God. They'll find sorrow. That's the contrast that we see here. So satisfied in his protection. Let's continue reading. So not only can we find that satisfaction guaranteed in the safety and security that God provides, but if you continue reading, we'll see that we can find satisfaction in his provision. Look at verse number 5. The Lord is the portion of mine inheritance. In my cup thou maintainest my lot. The lions are fallen unto me in unpleasant places, yet I have a goodly heritage. So what the psalmist is doing here is correctly understanding that only in God can he find his needs met. Only in him can he find his provision. And he says, the Lord is the portion of mine inheritance. There's a few things in these few phrases worth noting. First of all, in the Lord, we find our substance. So the verse we just read a moment ago, he refuses the cup of the wicked. Now for us as believers, it is good and it is right for us to refuse the cup of the wicked. It is right for us to abstain from the idols that are so prevalent in this world. But it's not enough just to abstain. And sometimes as believers, we get it half right, because we know there's a lot of things that we shouldn't do, but we don't do correctly is run to him and let him be our provision and our portion. I think this is really important with young adults and even children and teenagers, that they understand that yes, the world's provision will never satisfy. It'll never bring delight. But at the same time, if they're not pursuing God, they're never going to experience that true provision and satisfaction and sustenance that only he can bring. So he refuses rightly the cup of the wicked, but then he clings to the Lord as his portion and the Lord himself. You know, sometimes we want things from the Lord. We want blessings from the Lord more than we want just him. And what David said is, Lord, you are my portion. All that I need is you. I don't just need these bills paid. I don't need this problem taken care of. God, I just need you. You are my portion. You will sustain me. His portion, the Bible says in Psalm 23, that his cup overflows. And so we find the sustenance from the Lord. But then in the Lord, we find our inheritance. And we read this in verse number 6. Yea, I have a godly heritage. I love this truth because if you know anything about David, one of the things is David was the youngest, right? So David wouldn't really have had an earthly inheritance. But what David understands is I have not an earthly inheritance. I have a goodly, I have a godly inheritance. I have something. And what is that about an inheritance? It's not something that he earned or that he deserved. It's something that was given to him. It was the goodness of God, and he recognized that. The Bible says that every good gift And every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. That phrase, shadow of turning, if you think of like a sundial in ancient times, and you look at a sundial, if the sun's out, the shadow is always turning. Depending on the time of the day, you're going to find that shadow at a different spot. That's what James is referring to, this shadow of variableness. But with God and his goodness, there's no shadow of turning. It's constant, and it's good in our life. And so we find this inheritance from the Lord. It's a good inheritance, and we find the protection from the Lord. We find provision from the Lord, that he sustains, and that he also has given us an inheritance. We're going to see in just a moment in Christ. But the third place of satisfaction that we recognize here in this passage is satisfaction in his presence. Satisfaction in the presence of the Lord. Look at verse number 7. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also will instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. So what do we find in his presence? Well, we find, first of all, we find counsel, the counsel of the Lord. We know that wonderful prophecy in the book of Isaiah. We are reminded around Christmas time of this prophecy. For unto us is born, a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful. What's the next part? Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. So in him, we find counsel. In the Lord, David said, I find counsel. The Bible says, the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walks rightly. There is a lot of needs for counseling today, even in our church family, in our valley. I was at a city event a few months ago. I was talking to a public school counselor, and she was saying about how much counseling she does, and it seems to just kind of multiply and multiply. There's an abundance of counsel, but there's not an abundance of good counsel. In fact, if you go back to the garden, you find the serpent comes to Eve, and he gives them counsel. It's not good counsel. Really spiraled things out of control from there, didn't it? But from the Lord, we find perfect counsel. And I think there's a place for biblical counseling, and I'm thankful for those. I see some even in this room who are biblical counselors, and we need more biblical counselors. But let me just tell you this. It will do no good to go seek biblical counseling if you're not seeking God in his face. He is a wonderful counselor. There's no better counsel than the counsel of his word. And that's not to say that biblical counsel is not helpful. It is helpful and it has a place. But run to God first and know him personally as your counselor. And David said, you, Lord, you're my counselor. You give me counsel and also instruct me in the night seasons. Not only that, we find comfort. We find comfort. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also will instruct thee in the night season. The Bible talks about those, the watchman who stays up in vain. And the next verse talks about how he gives his blessed rest. And one of the things that David is mentioning here, my reins shall instruct me in the night season. How many of you guys have just ever had a lot on your mind that prevented you from sleeping? Anyone that ever happened to? That happens to me sometimes. And I don't know if your mind plays games with you like mine does, especially when I have to get up early. I'm like, okay, I really need to go to sleep. Am I the only one? Does that help me out here if that's happened to you before, right? You have to get up early, got to run to LAX. Like, I really need some sleep before I head out on this trip. Those are the nights that it's hard to find sleep. And maybe you've got a situation at work or something weighing on your mind, and you sleep is elusive to you. The Bible says that he will give us rest. He will instruct me in the night seasons. What David is talking about, and he had a lot on his mind. He had a lot on his heart. He was speaking of those times where even sleep was hard to come by. And yet, in that, what do we find? We find counsel from the Lord, but then the comfort from the Lord. That's what we find in his presence. We come to his presence, and in his presence, we enter his presence by opening up his word and coming to his throne of grace. And in that, we find counsel from the Lord. We found counsel from and the comfort from the Holy Spirit. But also, there's that comfort as well. So there's comfort. We are satisfied in his presence. But then I want you to notice number 4. We are then satisfied in his promises. So satisfied in his presence, but we find satisfaction in his promises. I remember back in the late 90s, Pepsi had this Pepsi challenge, and there's always been, if you look historically at the competition between Coca-Cola, how many Coke drinkers do we have in here? You like Coca-Cola, all right? How about Pepsi, right? It's about half and half, and that's if you look at the market share between Pepsi and Coke, it's always been that way. There's just, you can always take a poll and you'll find it about split 50-50. Well, Pepsi had a campaign back in the 1990s, and they had this Pepsi My Stuff campaign. Any of you remember this campaign? So I was in school, and I remember getting a magazine sent to our house, and it had this Pepsi Stuff magazine. I think you got a little closer picture here. What you did is you collected cans or 2-liter bottles, and you would earn Pepsi points. And so every 2-liter bottle would have some Pepsi points. And if you collected the points, you just cut them off the packaging. You can mail them to Pepsi, and they would redeem these. Here's a CD case, and here's some blue sunglasses. There's a bike, but there's a lot of, I remember there was a leather jacket. I remember getting this and thinking, man, this would be really cool. I could win all this Pepsi gear. This will be great to win all this stuff. Well, back at the same time, this is 1996, the Dallas Cowboys played the Pittsburgh Steelers in the Super Bowl, and during the height of this campaign that everyone, at least everyone here at school, was talking about, during the Super Bowl, Pepsi aired a television commercial where at the end of the commercial, they're talking about all this free stuff you could win, and they showed the picture of this Harrier jet, and they said, you could win this jet for 7 million Pepsi points. 7 million Pepsi points, and they aired the commercial. Well, there's a backstory to this commercial, that they rushed to get this commercial done as they made this commercial, and they didn't send it through their legal department for final sign-off. And they forgot to put a disclaimer at the bottom of the commercial. And there was a man sitting there. He was a man, at the time, he was a single college-age student, and he started to do the math. And he figured out that this jet was worth multi-millions of dollars, if not hundreds of millions of dollars for this jet. And he realized that the point value was about a dollar per point, and it didn't say that any purchase was necessary. You could actually go to the catalog, and if you were short on points, you could buy points. And so if you wanted the CD case and you only had 40 points, you could buy the extras. So he figured out for $7 million, he could buy this jet that was a lot more than $7 million. And he got some business friends together, went to some business people. They all looked at it, and they sent in a few of the Pepsi points and a check for $7 million in request for their Harrier jet. This wound up in years of legal battle. Pepsi did not respond. They were not happy about this. Ultimately, he did not get his jet. It was too good to be true. There was fine print. Yeah, fine print ruins everything, doesn't it? That would have been a great story. They should have just, like, even for the cleverness of all of it, they should have given him the jet. But they did not supply the jet. It was years in court, and he didn't get anything from it. And it was the fine print. You know, we see fine print everywhere. Stuff like must be 18 years old to win. Certain restrictions apply. Void where prohibited. Terms and conditions apply. Visit official rules. We see this stuff all the time. We don't even see it anymore because we see all the fine print. I want you to know something about the promises of God, specifically the promises that we're going to talk about in just a moment. There's no fine print. There's no exclusion clause. These are the promises of God that you can take to the bank. The Bible tells us, and one of the things, let me just say this, to understand about the promises of God is that in Scripture there are some promises that are conditional. And God says, if you do this, like in James chapter number 1, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. If you lack wisdom, if you ask of God, he'll give you the wisdom and he won't hold back. That's a conditional promise. But some of the greatest promises that we read in Scripture that find the most comfort, there's no condition placed on them. There's no condition placed on the promises of the goodness of God. This is a little detour. Are you guys okay for like a few minute detour about the promises of God? These are five promises of God with no strings attached, with no terms and conditions, no fine print. Number one, that God is always with me. This is a little detour. This is we're stepping away from Psalm 16 for just a second. Now, although we see this truth in Psalm 16, God is always with me. These are five promises that bring peace. Number one, that God is always with me. Now, for every promise, there is, for us, it should elicit a response. And our response is, I will not fear. Since God is with me, I will not fear. In Deuteronomy 31, verse 8, and the Lord, he it is that doth go before me. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee. He will not forsake thee. fear not, neither be dismayed. This is a promise we find in the Old Testament. We also rings true in the New Testament that he will never leave us or forsake us. He will be with us. And because he is with us, I shall not fear. God is always in control. And our response should be that I will not doubt. God is in control, and so I will not doubt. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understandings. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Speaking of directing thy path, he'll make your way passable. If he's in control, if he brought you to it, he can bring you through it. Now think about this for just a second. These first two promises, they're good. Let me give you the third one right here. God is always good. So he's with me and he's in control, but he's always good. Now think about these three promises here. If God is with you and he's in control, but he's not good, what comfort do you get from promise one and two? If God's in control and he's with you, but he's not good, what does it matter that he's in control? But this is what we delight in. This is what David delights in. The goodness of God. Remember, we started there. The goodness of God. I can't give you anything back, but God, you are good. So God is always with me, so I will not fear. God is always in control. I will not doubt. God is always good. So what response should we give to that? I will not despair because God is good. Psalm 23, verse 13. I had fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. There are moments that apart from the promise of the goodness of God, you may find yourself, like the psalmist said, I would have fainted. I couldn't continue to go forward. But because he is good, I continue, and I can go forward in his good. God is always good. He's so good, he can even in the book of Romans, we talk about how all of creation is groaning, and we live in a broken and fallen world, but just a few verses later, we read the promise that God can take even the difficult things and bring about good, and that's how good of a God he is. And so God is in control. He is with us. He is good. I will not despair. He's always watching. These are promises that are always true. There hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you will be able to bear it. And temptation, not only speaking of just temptation to lust, but just a testing, a difficult situation. If God will bring you to it, God can bring you through it. And so God is always good. He's always watching. And our response is, I will not falter. I'm weak. I can't go forward, but if he brought me to this moment, I can get, with God's help, through this moment. And then God is always victorious. We're going to come back to this, but because of this, I will not fail. Now, this is not just happy talk. This is not just thinking happy. No, we can read the end of the book. We know the end of the story, that Jesus conquers. He's conquered death, hell, and the grave, and he is victorious. And in Christ, we too are victorious. The Bible reads in Isaiah 54, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and the righteousness of me is of me, saith the Lord. So let's jump back into this passage, and let's talk about the promises that we experience in him. First of all, the promise of total and unrivaled peace. Look at this. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. Now, let's continue reading. My flesh also shall rest in hope. Now, I love this verse specifically because it mentions our heart and our flesh. Our heart and our flesh. So what is this promise? This promise that we can have peace in our hearts, but then in my flesh shall also rest in hope. This is complete and unrivaled peace. Unrivaled meaning you cannot go anywhere else to find the peace of God. Only God can offer the peace of God, only in his word, only time spent with him. And this is a promise that we have in Scripture, that we can experience the peace of God, a total peace, meaning not just our heart, but all of us. So total and unrivaled peace. Now, how can David claim this peace? Let's keep on reading in verse number 10. Verse number 10, thou wilt not leave my soul in hell. This is speaking of death and the grave. Neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. All right, let's look at those two verses, or those two words, thine Holy One. What is the Holy One that David is speaking to here? This is a great passage because this passage contains for us a Christological promise. This passage, the center of this passage is Jesus. Now, what we have to remember in the Old Testament, they only saw shadows and glimpses. So we look back to these moments. They looked forward to those moments. But in this moment, even though maybe they didn't fully understand even the end times timetable, and Job had written before this, "For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet my flesh shall I see God." And so there was glimpses of this Redeemer that they had heard of and that they knew. And so here, David, he speaks of this Holy One will not suffer. Who is he talking about? He's talking about Jesus. Take your Bibles with me and turn to Acts chapter number 2. Now, Acts 2 is a familiar passage to us, is it not? The church is just getting started, and we have here Peter preaching. In Acts 2, in verse number 24, we read, "Of whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holding of it. For David speaketh concerning him." So here is, we find Peter, he's preaching, and he's going to quote David. "I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I shall not be moved." Now he's quoting from the passage that we're studying tonight. "Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh rest in hope." Sound familiar? "Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou shalt thou suffer the Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make full of joy thy countenance." Men and brethren, let me speak freely unto you. The patriarch David, that is, he is both dead and buried. His sepulcher is with us in this day. And he goes on to say that this Holy One is Christ. Now, what comfort do we have in that? Because as Christ is victorious, we are victorious. He conquered death, hell, and the grave, so we can, in him, experience that life. We can experience that redemption. And so that's the victory that we have. We can hold on to the promise of his peace and the fact that the victory is secure. We can go to the end of the book of Revelation. We can find that God is going to make all things new, not just improved, not just better. He's going to make all things new. He is good, and he has given us victory over death. So let's go to verse number 11 and wrap this up. So what does this mean for today? This means that for today, we can find joy for today. We can find purpose for today. Look at verse number 11. "Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore." You'll show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy hand are pleasures forevermore. You know what that's a promise for? That's a promise for today. We live in the already not yet reality where we've been given promises from God. We're going to be new creatures. We are new creatures. It's the already not yet. The life that I now live by faith, I live in the flesh. I live by faith, right? So it's we're right here. We've been given the victory, but man, some days it doesn't feel like we have victory, right? But this is where we can come back to the promises of today. In his presence, there is joy. There are pleasures evermore at his right hand. Psalm 84, verse 10 says this, For a day in the courts is better than a thousand. He said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. My brother and I, we love to golf. We're not any good at golf, but we love to golf. I've golfed with a few of you in this room, so you can attest to that. I think Brother Cox can, Brother Alvarez can as well. But we love to golf, and a few years ago, we had the opportunity to go to the Masters tournament. And the Masters, it's the Super Bowl of golf, but I don't know. I think it's even cooler. And my dad was given some passes, and we were able to spend one day, me, my dad, and my brother, at Augusta National. This is something we'd seen on TV, that we'd watched, we'd studied about. But man, there was nothing like being there that day. And we walked in, and my brother and I, we actually made the joke, this must be what heaven's like, because you hear about it, it's described, and it's one of those places that surpasses like everything that you ever could have thought about it, right? So we walk into that morning, it was a Thursday morning, the tournament was just starting, so everyone was at the far side of the tournament for the inaugural tee off by some of the older professionals. And on this side of the course, this was the back side of the course where Amen Corner is located. And I think this is hole number 13. We walked in here and it looked just as beautiful as this picture. It looked like a picture as you were there. And that was such a fun day, a fun day with my dad that I'll never forget. And I was glad that we were able to experience it together. You can't bring a phone into Augusta National. There's a lot of rules. You can't run at Augusta National. I remember we saw they have pay phones. It's like stepping back in time. And he ran to the pay phone. I called Ashley. I'm like, we're here. You know, she's like, it's 4 a.m. here. I'm like, I don't care. We're here at the golf course right now. And it was pretty awesome. And I remember as the day started to wind down and come to an end, we wanted more of it. It was just one day, and everyone had finished out their round, and security is ushering everyone out. The sun hadn't even set yet. We stood there at the 18th hole, and we just looked at it. We just tried to soak it in for a minute, because like we don't know if we'll ever be back. And we stood there, and it was such a great moment. It was one day. And it was one day, and it left us wanting more, right? What David said was, a day in thy courts is better than 1,000 anywhere else. Lord, I just take one day in your presence, and it's better than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. And here's the promise that I want to leave you with, is that God doesn't promise us just a day. He promises us eternity. David said, I would just take one day in your presence. Lord, just give me one day. And God says, I can do better than that. I'm going to give you an eternity. And I'm not going to leave you with that feeling that my brother and my dad had, like, we just want more. Can we do this again? No, it's that every day in his presence. That's the promises that we find in his word. So what do we do with this as we conclude? Here's what we do. We take this passage personally. Take it personally. This is personal. If you read through these verses, and we won't read through them all again, find the amount of times that David used personal pronouns when he talked about My. This was personal to him. You know, David, another time in Psalm 42, verse 5, says, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou cast down? That's a question. Who is he asking that question to? Himself. He said, why are you cast down, O my soul? You know, we need to remind ourselves of these truths. Sometimes we think, you know, I know this, I got this. Here's David, right? Here's David that was so instrumental in the Lord's work that God used him in such profound ways. And here we find him elsewhere. Yes, he is here in this passage. He's speaking these truths clearly and plainly in an encouraging manner. But then elsewhere we say, why are you cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted in me? And then he has to remind himself, hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. So what do we do with this passage? We take it personally. We apply it to ourselves. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Sometimes we need to remind ourselves of these truths because we find in a world chasing satisfaction, if we're not careful, we run in the same direction as the wicked. We run in the same direction as those who have no hope. And this passage provides for us an alignment to understand that our hope is placed properly and that in that hope there's satisfaction. So I just simply tonight have the question for you. Are you satisfied? Are you satisfied in the way that David was satisfied? I don't think this is a plateau that we reach in our Christian life where we're at this level of satisfaction and I don't need it anymore. No, David had to continually encourage himself in the Lord and continually remind himself of these truths. Are you satisfied in his protection? Maybe someone here tonight, and I don't know everyone in this room, but maybe someone has been running from God in a difficulty you're facing. Maybe no one else in this room even knows. But your decision, I'm gonna run to him. Maybe you've looked elsewhere for provision, maybe even your own means to you're a resourceful person. I could fix this problem. And what you were reminded of tonight is that he is our sustenance. And in Christ, we have an inheritance, not that we deserved or were owed, but it was because of his goodness. Are you satisfied in his protection? Are you satisfied in his provision? Are you satisfied in his presence? Have you ran to him lately for counsel, for comfort? Are you satisfied in his promises? Recognizing that in his promises, there's no fine print. In his promises, we find peace, we find victory. And we find joy. I know it's just a midweek service, and we'll give some prayer requests here in a moment and be done, but in the quietness of this moment, the piano's going to play here in just a second, and I'm going to have a word of prayer, and let's all stand to our feet, and we'll have a word of prayer together. And I just want to take a moment to give ourselves just an opportunity to go to the Lord and run to Him, and just remind ourselves of the fact that He is our refuge, He is our strength, He is our fortress. And maybe there's someone here tonight that doesn't have a personal relationship with God. I'd invite you in this moment. Would you come forward and maybe talk to one of us at the front here? And maybe you need to just take a minute to quietly there at your chair, turn around and pray, or you can come forward. But if you're here tonight and you can't say, I am completely satisfied in Him, I've not brought Him glory in that way, it's as simply as choosing as David did. I'm going to choose to place my satisfaction. And it's a promise that He can come through on and that you will find realized in your life. I'm going to have a word of prayer, and then I'll just step away from the microphone for just a moment, and we'll just take a moment in prayer. I'd invite you to come forward if the Lord leads you that way. If you don't know Christ, we'd love to talk to you, and maybe you'd like to just spend a moment there, even at your seat. But let's reflect on His goodness and then our satisfaction in that. Our Heavenly Father, thank You for the comfort that we find in Your word this evening. We thank You for the reminder that we have as believers that only You can satisfy. God, may we turn to Your word, may we turn to Your throne, and may we find satisfaction in the fellowship of other believers here. And God, if there's someone here that's lacking satisfaction in one of these areas, I pray that they wouldn't leave tonight without redirecting their heart towards You. And we pray all of these things in Jesus' name, amen. If the Lord leads you, you respond at this time. We'll take a moment of prayer, and then we'll close out.